cord here.
Actually worked. Welcome to Sonic Talk number 325, recording today live on Wednesday the 7th of August. We're now in the clasps of summer and the sun's gone away, but it's actually quite nice to be a bit cooler for a change. And I want to say welcome. We've got a small, lovely collective of guests. But first I'll say, obviously, thanks to our sponsors, isotope.com. Check out Stutter Edit. A bit more on that later. We have a competition announcement to announce and a new competition to announce. So do hang on and see if you can get a win or find out if you did win last week. But first of all, we're going to go to our guests. I'm going to go to Rich Hilton. Rich Hilton, I haven't seen him for a long time. Rich, of course, plays in the band Chic, which is where he has been for the most of the summer, posting all sorts of pictures of himself with celebrities and in exotic parts of the world, and hearing about your travels. How are you, Rich?
Very well, thank you.
Good. I'm ever so glad to hear that.
Me too.
So you just got back quite recently, right?
Yeah, got back last Saturday.
Right, wow. So what was the last gig you played?
The last gig, wow, there's a quiz.
I don't know. Why not?
The last gig we played was in Sète, France, in a place called Théâtre de la Mer, which had featured the Mediterranean Sea to our backs as we played into this, what looked like ancient fortress, and which splayed out like an amphitheater. And,
wow, that sounds nice. Wow.
It was pretty cool.
Was the sun shining?
Or the moon was shining.
That sounds gorgeous. That sounds the sort of gigs that it's worth traveling thousands of miles for, rather than rainy festival muddy gigs.
They've all been incredible, really. It's just an amazing time for this music in the world.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. And it really is kind of, it's golden moments, I think. I hope you can look back on this summer so far. And there's more gigs to do, actually, haven't you? You've still got some more dates.
Yeah, and they're popping up daily.
I can imagine.
Apparently, I'm getting on a plane in one of the next 2 days and flying off somewhere to do a quick gig.
Excellent. Seriously. Nice work. Oh, you're looking very well, Rich.
Thank you.
So thank you very much for coming on. And, of course, we've also got Mr. Gaz Williams right over there, who's back in his place in Bristol, who's also back, played Fuji Rock with Carl Hyde, his bass player. That's not Dave. Sorry about that. That's Gaz Williams at Goldstar, songsurgery.co.uk. Currently, really, a professional bass player, I think, would be fair to say. Would that be reasonable?
Well, yeah, this year has been very bassy. And it really does kind of tap into my deepest passion, I suppose. And, you know, and I've kind of multitasked over the years trying to learn to do different things to make a living, I suppose. But when it comes to it, there's nothing that makes me happier than sort of playing, especially to 60,000 people.
Yeah, that's a rocket. That sounded like a rocket. That was a special moment there. And, of course, in the middle of your honeymoon, because you are now a married man.
Yeah, it was amazing. That was a really like a fantasy honeymoon. It was superb. And then once we got back, it was straight off with the David Rhodes trio, where we went to play in Liechtenstein. And it was quite a funny story that just quickly like to tell is that so I arrived at the airport in Zurich in Switzerland, and the taxi came to collect us. The promoter came along too, and this is a terrific chap called Alex Nussbaumer. I hope that's the right pronunciation. But he's a great guy, very enthusiastic, full of energy, and super chap. And so in the trio was David Rhodes and Jed Lynch, both Peter Gabriel's band musicians, and myself. And Alex was going, hi guys, Gaz, oh yeah, Gaz, I know you, Gaz, don't I? We know each other. And I was like, no. He's going, yeah, yeah. He was adamant that he knew me. And then I was going, and I was getting a bit embarrassed then because I knew I'd never met him before. And he just going, yeah, Gaz, did you come over with the last David Rhodes? Are we over on the Peter Gabriel tour? And I was like, no. And he was like, he wouldn't let it go. He knew me. It was absolutely. And then a little bit later, he just went, Sonic State. And he's a big podcast. He listens to podcast every week.
Oh, awesome.
Yeah.
What was his name?
Alex Nussbaumer. Yeah, Alex Nussbaumer.
Hello, Alex. Fantastic guy. If you're listening.
Really, really cool guy. Yeah, I'm sure he will. He listens to it every week. So, yeah, I just thought I'd mention that because it was real fun.
Ah, great. Well, thanks for letting us know about that. And thanks, Alex, for taking such good care of Gaz.
Yeah.
Put a little extra something in his rider.
But they do this thing, and that's the thing we were doing in Liechtenstein, this little big sessions. And we went into a recording studio and did like a live session in front of a very small audience of about maybe 30 or 40 people. And like Liechtenstein is, I think, the second richest country in the world. So I was kind of expecting the studio to be this very sort of, ultra slick modern place. And we arrived at the studio and we went in there, and it kind of resembled like a 1970s studio. It was very clean, very nice, but it had this very old-fashioned look about it. And,
oh, cool.
And we did a session, and it was onto 24-track 2-inch, and they had a clasp system in there, which is the first time I've seen one of those out in the wild, and a microphone cupboard to die for. I mean, really, it was... Did you insist?
I want that one on my bass, please.
Well, I think they'd already sort of put out. And well, what did they put? They put an RE20 on the bass, which I love that on the bass.
Yeah.
But just a collection of mics they had, and I was I don't know. I for the other mic fetishists out there, and I know there's many. You know, when you see that sort of thing, it really is. I'm rubbing my jeans. Just look, you know. But yeah, I just wanted to show one last thing. And when I was in Tokyo a few weeks back, I went to this music shop that was a really cool place and loads of music tech stuff there. And I was looking to get something. And the only thing that I could see that I thought was really cool was one of these. And see if you can work out what it is. There we are.
It looks like a sort of drinks holder type thing. No, I have no idea. It's
a headphone hanger, and it kind of clips on under your desk. and now that sounds like a really, you know, mundane thing. But the amount of headphones I've broken just from not having a dedicated place for them. In fact, I did break my beloved HD650s live on Sonic Tour.
Oh, no.
Yeah, well, I went to move and got tangled up and pulled them and broke them.
The chat room, they got it. Somebody got it in the chat room as well. Yeah, that was awesome.
Maybe. Yeah. Sorry, not particularly exciting, but I haven't seen them available anywhere else. They are made by Audio Technica, but yeah, highly recommended little tiny thing. So,
we had to go all the way to Japan to find a bit of novel technology. Excellent. Rich, do you get a chance to do much shopping while you're out on the road? Have you managed to pick up anything of a great interest in your travels, or was it traveling light? Save the space for wine. Or ale.
Well, I didn't even have weight left for wine in my bags this time because it was a long trip. I took too much with me. So everything was, and everybody had overweight bags anyway, but I received some gifts, and I don't tend to, I'm not a real shopping guy much. I don't, you know, enjoy the hunt as much as some seem to, but many do. And I respect that. So no, not a lot of shopping. If it is, it's usually for practical reasons. And a few gifts came back with me.
Super.
A festival shirt right here.
Cool.
For example, which I got in Vence the night that preceded the night in Set. And yeah, so
nice flat pack things that you're easily to transport. Well, that's excellent. Well, we've got a few topics this week. I mean, there was a last one, a late one that came in, which is rather sad news, but in some ways it's it's news that allows us to celebrate something as well. And I'm just going to play a little bit. I've got a clip lined up, which I think is worth checking out. And this is obviously the news is sad, but let's see if anyone can agree. I'm going to fast forward this to a particular point where it really gets going, and it's just super groovy.
Funk it down.
Here we go.
Give it to me.
Now that the bridge is on this side of the border.
Give me some of that.
Won't y'all come on over here with us? Wanna walk the water? And if you ever should see a skunk shake his rump, tell him to come on over here for some
snake funk in the dump, baby.
Now we got this stick that will set you free. All you got to do is take a closer walk with me. And we got this bang that's full of magic tricks.
Sheila E. there, for those of you who are spotting.
The magic of the Duke stick.
Total P-Funk kind of vibe is. Absolutely brilliant. Oh, yeah. Well, of course, this is could be none other than George Duke, who, of course, passed in the early hours of this morning. Amazing. Not only amazing pianist, but amazing synthesist, musician, just everything. And that was probably his most accessible kind of works, maybe. I think that might have been actually charted, Dukey Stick. And I looked for that because I thought he was playing his kind of Gleeman pentaphonic Perspex vibe that he had, but it wasn't on that one. There are others. But as I was looking around, I found some amazing stuff. There's also, I might play out a little bit with when he was playing with Frank Zappa. And as Gaz said earlier, pre-show, you know, that's probably some of Zappa's finest material. And he sang, he played some amazing stuff. I know, Rich, I picked this up because you posted on your Facebook, and I know that you kind of met and had dealings with George. So it seems only fitting that we should go to you first, really.
I met George only a couple of times. And I guess what I posted was a bit misconstrued to believe that I knew him very well, which is not the case. But in the times that I met him, he was extremely gracious. And watching him, I was just a huge fan from the very early 70s onward, when I became exposed to him through my hearing Jean-Luc Ponty's album about the music of Frank Zappa, on which George played trombone and keyboards.
Really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's astonishing.
And he also played trombone in Frank Zappa's 200 Motels movie. And that was right around the time when he first joined Frank Zappa. And I was familiar with his work through Frank Zappa. And I saw his first solo gig as a trio at Philharmonic Hall in New York in like 1973. And was buying his albums on BASF Records long before the Dookie Stick period. And was thrilled to meet him when I did, and took just extraordinary amounts of influence from him as I grew as a musician. So his connection to me is pretty much would have been unknown to him. It had more to do with my
your affinity, yeah,
of what he had done. And I'm shocked that
I mean, it's just so sudden and sad. I mean, yeah, he was. The thing is, you look at all of you, particularly look at that video and look at everything, he's just like. He seems like such a big, friendly guy, you know, and it's like really sort of happy, healthy, and kind of just getting on with stuff. And but the thing that's really interesting, I was looking through because he played with, you know, Billy Cobham, he played with Jean-Luc Ponty, as you said, Frank Zappa, played with like kind of pretty much everyone you could possibly think of. Stanley Clark, the Stanley Clark and George Duke band. I mean, they toured a lot in Europe, actually, and I think they did quite a lot of the same perennial gigs that maybe Chic have done, like Montreux and also all those kind of things. And he's just been kind of flying the flag. There he is on the front.
This month's just arrived at my door.
Oh, man.
Cover story.
No way.
In Keyboard Magazine is George Duke.
That is
written by my friend Jerry Kovarsky, who probably a bunch of you know.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Jerry himself is a wonderful, wonderful human being. Worked many years in the industry for a bunch of different companies, including Casio and Sonic and Korg.
Yeah.
And Jerry's a keyboardist himself, excellent keyboardist, and a really great guy. And Jerry had done all this interview time with George. And, you know, yesterday morning I awakened to this news that George has passed, and simultaneously on the steps leading up this up here from yesterday's mail was this magazine with George on the front cover.
Wow, I don't know what you say. It's kind of like, I suppose in some respects it gives, because I mean, one thing that I've discovered, you know, through just looking for George Duke stuff and the things that I remember, I've discovered all this other stuff, and it sent me on all sorts of musical journeys. So that's kind of great in a way. As I said, you know, it's brilliant. And I don't think many people would have necessarily been aware of him, you know, perhaps less. I mean, he was a mainstream musician, but he was also supportive in a lot of ways rather than kind of up front. And I think perhaps that people aren't aware of some of the stuff that he did. So, you know, perhaps that will be good. You know, at least more people will have the opportunity to see what he actually achieved.
Well, yeah.
So, I mean, that's something, I guess.
The pinnacle of that Zappa band, as I believe Gaz was referring to, is recorded on a CD collection called You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore. And volume two is a complete concert by that band at the height of their powers.
Is it Helsinki, is it?
I think it's Finland. And I was listening to some of it yesterday. I was listening to Inca Roads in particular.
Jesus,
It's just mind-boggling how good they were.
I've been listening to Inca Roads too, and in fact, I have it queued up for a playout because it's the one of my favorite keyboard solos of all time. Actually, is in Inca Roads, and what's amazing about that whole thing, and this is probably going a bit off topic because we haven't played it yet, but it was so complex. But so it seemed played with such ease. When you see, I can't remember her name, is it somebody Underwood who was the percussionist? And she's playing all that Underwood. Really just ridiculous marimba stuff. And you're just going, what? How's that possible? It's just, it's very.
They were that good.
They were that good. Gas, I know you're probably enjoyed some of George Duke's work yourself.
Definitely. And, you know, and that Zappa period, sort of 74, 75, albums like One Size Fits All, which for me, that's my favourite Zappa album. And George Duke is so very kind of huge on that album. Really gutted. But the thing, the little tale I wanted to tell was a couple of weeks back, I managed to see a band who had been wanting to see for a while. And it's funny because I thought of George Duke because the keyboard player in this band, the band is called Snarky Puppy, and I'm just raving about them. They're a Brooklyn-based, they're like a kind of modern jazz funk fusion band who are sort of doing music that we haven't heard since like those George Duke albums of the 70s. But they're doing it with a real modern flavor, and it's stunning. And the keyboard player is a guy called Corey Henry. And when I saw him play, I thought of George Duke, you know, because he was smiling and he was putting so much expression, and he was playing like a lot of monosynth stuff, and a lot of synth soloing. He is incredible. But I thought of George Duke, and I thought, wow, this is almost like the new George Duke. And so George Duke was quite present in my mind because this gig was just 2 weeks ago. Then what I was going to say, he was playing as well, interestingly. He was playing a King Korg, and I was super impressed with the sound of that, actually.
I must check it out. What's it called again?
The band is called Snarky Puppy.
Snarky Puppy, right.
Yeah. Okay, now, what they do, and I think will be something that maybe will grow to be a more common thing. I think I've talked about this before, which is whenever Snarky Puppy record, they always record it live, and they do it in a studio with a small audience, a bit like the session that I just did with David Rhodes on Friday. So what you see is what you get, you know, or rather, you know, when you listen to those out. Yeah, and when you listen to their tracks, you know, you can hear a smattering of about 10 people clapping at the end of each track or something. But that's their kind of thing. They just do it live.
That's a really interesting concept, actually, because, I mean, then you put the time into the rehearsal rather than the recording, and if you're playing...
The way it always used to be, and that's why records in the past are so much better than they are today, because that's where the work got done, rather than, you know, the way it is now, just a farty little bit of performance and just tweak the hell out of it in Pro Tools. But what I was going to say, though, that... seeing him playing a King Korg, and I've not seen a King Korg being used before, so, and he was really great at just subtly getting nuances out of the keyboard. You know, he was using real-time controls or whatever, but he was really like a mono, you know, playing it like a mono synth and just putting plenty of...
It's a very expressive instrument. It's sadly, yes. As I said before, when we reviewed it, it sadly got rather under the shadow of the MS-20 Mini, which is kind of crazy because the MS-20 Mini is nothing new, whereas the King Korg sort of is, I suppose.
Do you know what? That King Korg sound, in that context, sounded fantastic, you know. And again, just to bring back that sort of George Duke thing, when you see George Duke play like on the Mini Moog or something, you know, he's using the mod wheels and the pitch wheels like all the time and getting just so much expression in his playing, and you see it in his face, don't you, as he's playing, you know, such an expressive
I found a piano solo as well, and it's just like, it's madness what he was able to do.
You know what it is with George Duke? He plays with love, doesn't he? It's just love. He's one of them players who just emanates love as he plays, and he, you know.
Yeah, I think you're probably right, actually. And we did do a talk on the. There was that from NAMM. Remember, there was the MIDI panel, 40 years of MIDI, and there was Jordan Rudess and Craig Anderton and George Duke and a couple of Dave Smith and a couple of other people, and they were all involved in that chat. And that was just really nice. If you want to sort of see George in a kind of. Normal, you know, non-performing kind of role, that's really worth a look, because he had some very interesting things to say as well. But yeah, it's sad news, but I think, you know, let's celebrate by going off and finding as much George Duke material and you know, seeing the stuff that he played in. I mean, he's golden, you know, he had
huge legacy,
absolutely. So yes, sort of sad, but I'm trying to think of it as uplifting as well. I've been listening to George Duke stuff all day, which is kind of not something I do very often, so I'm quite glad about that in a lot of ways. Right, I think we should probably. I was going to have a look at this one. This is kind of cool. This is. And I don't know if I've got the right button because I'm a bit. Ah, here we go. This was very interesting, which I think came out before already, but it's been reissued, and it's just a great idea. This is a talk that Benge gave for AV in. He's very, very nervous, so I'm not sure if it's his finest work, but what it essentially. He's talking about the history of. Synthesizers, but he's released this album, re-released the album called 20 Systems, which is kind of just 20 tracks of starting in 1968, 69, 70, 71. So it starts with the Moog modular, VCS3, up 2500, 2600, Surge modular goes right up. Kawai K5M, 1987 is when he stopped. So he's sort of done 20 years or 20 sort of what he considers to be groundbreaking. I'll see if I can play when anything will come out. I wonder if it will play on this. Let's have a look. But it's actually a really cool idea, and perhaps something that only he could have done, considering he's got pretty much everything there is to have. And I wondered whether there's anything else like this, because I've never really seen one like this at all. Ah, here we go. There's a bit of sound. This is... what did I just play? I think this was ARP. So let's try. The Moog modular sounded pretty special, because I know that he used it a lot on one of my favourite albums from a couple of years ago, which was... Interplay by John Fox and the Maths. Love it. Can't really hear this because it's so sub. It's not making terribly good radio, I must admit, but that's okay. Mm-hmm. But fantastic idea. And Rich, you worked as a synthesizer salesman, you know, for a certain amount of time, didn't you? So I'm imagining that you kind of know a lot of this stuff already.
It all sounds to me as expected. It all sounds idiomatic of the instruments he's describing. Yes. The ones I played about, I don't know, 10 of them. And typically, like, the earliest 10, because those are the ones that interest me the most. Although there were a few further down, like the Oberheim Expander that I listened to. But everything sounds as it should.
Yeah, it's a great idea, though, as a concept album. I think it's something everybody who has a lot of synthesizers should probably do. You know, it's like you need to make all these tracks, because these are all, they're, you know, varying from sort of two to six or seven minutes, 20 tracks. And it's just I just think it's a great, it goes back to that kind of idea of concept albums, but it's sort of, it seems to fit. I'm going to have to go and buy it. I haven't bought it yet, but it seems to fit perfectly. You know, it seems to be made for me.
Yeah.
And a few of my friends.
One of the things I really liked about it was the fact that he didn't use any effects. So it really is the sound of those keyboards. So, and I like his music as well. I think he's a good writer. And I just like the sort of the dryness of it all.
It was interesting. CR78, the tone. Sorry, CR78 is written in the chat room. 20 Systems is what started the partnership between John Fox and Benge. John heard the album and tracked Benge down, because I think it was 2008 when that first came out.
Yes.
That's an interesting fact. I didn't know that. Thank you very much, CR78. Good top tip. As I said, the chat room, our giant brain, sonicstate.com live, do check them out, and you can participate and help. But yeah, it's a great idea, really. I mean, there is some melodic stuff there as well, something that you could kind of groove on. It's not just, you know, whittle, whittle, whittle. Any favourites? I haven't listened to it all, and I'm putting you on the spot, assuming you have listened to all of them and anything stood out.
I really liked, there was a lot that I liked. I really liked, the SH-2000 one. I just really, really liked that because it's quite an odd piece of music, but there's just a kind of purity to the sound on that one. This is it.
Excellent. I wonder if he must have layered some of these things up, so they're layered.
Yeah, he says he layered them and he used the click track, but
it's a great idea. I must admit, I said last week, I've been working on some music, and I've just really dug the idea of turning on a synth and recording it and just not messing around with software at all. But I'll tell you one tip that I did find is, like, certainly with the Jupiter 6, I record something, and because the MIDI's not working properly, like you can't get the filter sweeps or anything like that, I just open the filter wide up, record the part that I made, and then put a filter on it in software and automate that. And that's something, so I'm able to get the live performance, but that, and then maybe trigger. The other thing I was doing is, if you want to have a filter envelope, this is in Logic, I was doing it, just a basic Logic 9 track, you in the auto filter plugin, you can sidechain it, so you can trigger. You can send a trigger from, say, a bass drum or something like that, that will then filter. You can create the envelope filter on top of the overall filter. So, yeah, I think that's something that I found, just sort of discovered as a technique, and it meant that I could do fancy stuff afterwards, but still retain the essence of the sound that I'd made in the Jupiter 6. Just thought I'd mention that. Rich, you're going to be doing any studio stuff, or you're pretty much in the live world at the moment?
No, I'm going to the studio today.
Oh, right, okay.
I don't know. I believe it's mostly voice recording today, but I'll be in the studio, yes.
Excellent. Okay. Let's see. I think somebody just tried to Skype in. I don't know if that was, who was that? Oh, that seems to be Mark Tinley. I thought Mark was, Mark said he's had his operation and he's not dead, because he was getting a bit worried. Mark actually had, I think one of his feet he had operated on a couple of weeks ago or a few months ago, and now he had the other one. So glad to hear that Mark's doing very well there. So super. I think probably this is a good time to, with that fabulous good news, we should probably go our little ad spot for Isotope. So after this ad, there will be an announcement of a competition. So I'll play this now, and I will tell you all about the Isotope Stutter Edit. A stutter edit is effectively, it's an effect that allows you to slice and cut up audio in real time, trigger patterns via MIDI. You can reverse things, you can get granular, you've got filtering effects. It's done in conjunction with Brian Tranzo, BT, who was the king of cut and slice for a time, and sort of came up with the idea and the notion of this, and Isotope helped realise it for it. And you could have cutting edge audio slicing manipulation, you can reinvent your music and slice, you can put it on the master bus and then do turnarounds if you record a pass and play them out. Some really good ideas for little breakdowns and all sorts of stuff. Just lots of inventive and interesting results. You can take the MIDI input from a keyboard and do all sorts of stuff. Download a free 10-day trial, isotope.com/stutteredit, and you could get a fully functional trial. And as you can see there in the video, the presets could be triggered by keyboard triggers and all sorts of other things. It really is a very powerful, as we've come to expect from Isotope, and you know, it's great to have them as a sponsor because we get to showcase all of their products, which are pretty fabulous most of the time. Well, all of the time. So, sorry, I am rambling now, but I want to say that last week we asked a question for sound design tricks, and I got this via somebody called Sven Synthetics on the chat room. On the comments in the Sonic State site, so I haven't got his email address, so if he can get in touch with me, that'd be great. He says, here is a sound design trick. It works very good with pads and atmospheric stuff. You record your pad, put it in your iPod. From the iPod, there is a radio transmitter, so you can listen to it on your radio in your car or somewhere else. You can transmit from your iPad to the radio and play with the frequencies on the radio so that you add stutter and noise and all sorts of kind of weird, unusual radio tuning type stuff for not quite the right frequency. Record it back, and then you've got some processing, which sounds... I like the idea of taking it out and physically having to do that. It reminds me of going back to listening to stuff in the car, checking mixes in the car. So if he would like to get in touch, Sven Synthetics, if he's in the chat room or anywhere else, please do get in touch with me, sonictalk@sonicstate.com or any of the other methods, Twitter, @sonicnick, all of those things. And we will get the Isotope Fairy to give you your copy of Stutter Edit. So thank you very much. And this week, we have another competition that, again, another copy of Stutter Edit is up for grabs. I think you might be seeing a pattern here somewhere. What you need to do is just tell us your three favourite studio tools. They could be hardware or software. Just want to list it. Remember, all you have to do, list them in the comments below, either on YouTube or on the Sonic State site, depending on where you're watching this, or send it in however way you can. And we will pick a winner from next week. And I think, if I'm right, I think Isotope may well be coming to Sonic Towers, and so we may have a representative here to join us on the podcast. So maybe they'll have some news, or we can get them to set a competition question for us live. So once again, thanks to them for their sponsorship of the show. Excuse me, terrible hiccups. Right, our next topic is... I'm going to skip the support one because Dave really wanted to have a go at that. Ah, this was a funny... Yes, this was... now, if I could have got the right video for this. Yes, here we go. Great visual gag. I don't know where the studio is. It looks very nice.
It's dramatic. We're not going to make it.
You can see the Lexicon 480L controller in the middle there.
But I will keep on going till the end.
Ah. Hey. Fairly derivative anthemic tune, but, you know, good singing.
Our ship has faced a hurricane, but I will keep on going.
Ah, it's the oldie but goodie. That was the terrible singing that just dealt with the engineer, but it got me thinking about a topic. I know this doesn't happen to probably you guys very often because you're working at such a high level. And so generally people that get into the studio, unless it's, I've got my daughter's friend wants to come in, can you just record something for her? But that moment when the performance happens and you press record, and it's the first time you hear whoever it is that's doing what they do, and all you can see, obviously doing that in that level of fixing in real time is pretty impossible, but... That thought that you're always thinking at the time, oh my God, I'm going to have to fix this somehow. I'm going to have to fix this somehow. And that's a terrible moment. How do you handle it? I'm going to go to you first, Gaz, because I'm sure Rich has got something as well up his sleeve. That you don't have to name any names. We don't want any...
good grief. I mean, I have talked about some horror stories in the past. I think the X Factor one was one that springs to mind.
Oh, that was a cracking story, yes. I wish I could remember the exact episode that we had that on because it's a brilliant tale, yes.
I remember another time this girl was doing a session. It was for a Radio Wales session, a Radio Cymru session, which is the Welsh language station in Wales. So it was sung in Welsh, and this singer came in to do it, and she really wasn't very good at all. But it was her family had been making a big fuss about her and this, that, and the other, and it ended up being like literally a melodyning every single syllable of it. But her voice was so squeaky. Now Rich will really appreciate this little bit. In order to sort of de-squeakify her voice, we used the formant shifting. it down a lot. You know, normally with formant shifting, you know, if you're doing it, you do it quite subtly. But in this case, it brought it right down and, you know, kind of give her voice quite like a husky, full quality. And you know, and then everybody's really happy with it. And the family, the family, I think they made 1,000 CDs of it. And, you know,
but you did your job.
I know, but I was kind of thinking, this is so deceit. Percentage of her voice is kind of real on the end of that? You know, I mean, especially with the formant, you know, shifting is, you know, given.
I guess the worst thing is at that point they'll use that CD and she'll get a gig or something and have to go and perform it live. And then the moment that it actually happens, there'll be a change. Yeah.
Wow.
That's that. Yeah. I've done it a couple of times, but I mean, mostly I used to work with a rapper who was really came up with fantastic ideas. And he sort of go, oh, this sample, that sample. And it was just brilliant. And, you know, I'd put it together and sort of beef it up with a bit of extra bass drum and just, you know, and so make backing tracks for his band. And he had brilliant, brilliant ideas. And then when it came to do the rap, he'd just get so excited and so wound up, he just could not rap in time at all. And it was actually really problematic because the raps were good as well, but he just could not actually hit the rhythm in any way for any more than like two syllables. And that was before, you know, that. So anything that I had to do had to be done in the sampler, you know, and it was really, really, you know, it was just the first moment I was just thinking, oh, that's such a shame. But everything else, you know, great ideas. So now I'm sure you can do stuff. So, Rich, I've purposely come to you last because I'm sure you probably have to choose which or when, because I'm sure it's happened in your illustrious career in the studio that you've had that have to deal with that moment where it's, you know, oh, is that what you're doing?
No, that's never happened.
Oh, I'm so happy for you.
But I do have a good story about a use of Melodyne. In the preparation for the movie Semi-Pro, which is an American movie about basketball that's kind of a farce starring Will Ferrell, I was given a recording of a script reading which had the song lyrics on it, but the song hadn't been written yet. And Will Ferrell just launched into this melody that came to him. And it was decided by my friend, the producer, that this was the melody we would use to create the song.
Okay.
That was the foundation, really, of the movie called Love Me Sexy, because the plot involved a guy who was a one-hit wonder in the early 70s buying a basketball team. So you had to have the one hit that was the one-hit wonder that was the driving force behind the entire plot of the movie. And what I ended up doing was taking this, you know, whatever kind of room recording, somebody had their iPhone halfway across the room kind of running deal, and popping it into Melodyne and pitching it to the nearest local key. And we used that as the foundation to write the chorus for the song.
Okay. Well, that's cool. But so that you had to kind of, because it was sung freeform, I guess. Is that?
Yeah,
that,
he was just, yeah, there was no pitch reference. There was no backing track. There was nothing. He just got to those words and started singing. And that's what came out.
But I suppose that's the thing, isn't it? That, I mean, that's something that, you know, I'm in no way trying to kind of align what I do with any of those sort of people with that talent. But capturing the moment at the time the idea is coming out is actually really, really important. And some people are absolutely notorious and fastidious about it and have things running all the time and, you know, just everything I say or whatever. I mean, do you work with people in that way? I mean, is that something you find you have to do a lot, or is it mostly kind of, okay, we've talked about it, we've arranged it, now's the time for performance?
I try to record everything, but I don't always record conversational things.
No, sure.
Like between take conversation, it starts to feel like surveillance to them. And I don't think you want to create that either.
Insurance.
That said, I would be lying if I said I haven't run a DAT in the background in the old days for certain sessions that shall remain nameless. But
how great.
And I just recorded everything that happened because the person in the room meant that much to me. But not visibly and not in a way that affects the workflow.
Right.
So you try to record everything that the person is doing deliberately. And if you happen to catch some of the stuff they're not doing deliberately, or you record, for example, the pass where you're still getting the sound going, because who knows what they'll do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Because there's no pressure, I suppose. And that's it. But does that work with any, I mean, are you speaking mostly vocalists, or is that instrumentalists too?
Just
whoever, people who do stuff.
Nowadays, just be and record, because what does it cost you?
Yeah.
Disk space?
Yeah, no, that's a good point. How about you, Gaz? Do you find you do try and do that? Or, I mean, because you work very quickly, don't you, as well? And sometimes I imagine that just even on for your own stuff,
yeah,
and coming out, you know, is worth capturing, because the next time you do it, your brain will automatically modify something, won't it?
Well, Reaper has got a great function, and I'd like to see that in every door, which is just a sort of just you can just with a you can assign a keystroke and it will just record a stereo file of whatever's, you know, appearing at the
outputs.
Yeah. So that's quite cool, and I've used that in the past. But I have to say, I love studio chatter, especially when you go back years later.
Ah, the trogs.
Yeah, but I do. I love it. I love it from sort of a nostalgic point of view, just to remember things, but and just to have little bits of people's personalities sort of captured. But it is a bit like surveillance, but it's great. As I say, a few years down the line, it's just it's lovely, and I like taking lifting little bits of the studio chatter and just dropping it into other things.
Well, that's interesting. AKA Tinley or Tinley, A Not Dead Tinley in the chat room just said, you know, it's when you get time to listen back to it all. And that's a very good point, because that's the other thing you're thinking. If you record everything, you're just going, I suppose the point is if you've got it and somebody says, hey, did you get that? Then you can at least, you know, go and find it, but you wouldn't normally bother, right?
With Cubase, I've always got the retrospective record turned on, and I think it goes back a few minutes. I think I can't remember what I've set that to. I'll have a look.
Retrospective record. I like the idea. So it records.
Yeah.
So it's
recording in playback, and then when you start recording, you can then pull it back. And
how does that work? Does that work with? Does the record the channel have to be an input monitor?
No, just as long as the track is kind of armed, whatever track is armed will be recorded.
Okay.
I'm just trying to have a look on my Cubase to see what I've got it set to. I have had it set to different amounts in the past. Pre-records. I've just got 6 seconds. Of pre-record. But I mean, I'm just looking what I could set.
You can do a lot in 6 seconds, right? One.
Yeah, I could have it. I'm just looking at 32 seconds. Let's try 100 seconds.
And it'll just
60. It looks like 60 seconds.
60 seconds is the maximum.
Yeah.
Interesting idea for a Notion for work. Mm. I mean, that's the one thing I find with certainly with most DAWs that I've used, and I sort of miss that kind of Atari style big tape transport, so you can just quickly hit a button and kind of go, I want these channels in record. I mean, I know, Rich, you don't use a control surface, do you, with what you're doing? So, I mean, is, you know, you've got to kind of mouse around and go, oh, quick, record that channel. So do you find that's actually, even though disk space is less of an issue, it's actually, is it slower? Could you miss things if you're not kind of, don't have the channels in the right part of the window or whatever? Well, yeah, find that an issue.
I suppose. You could.
One might.
You try not to, and sometimes you might.
Okay. Well, anyway, I enjoyed, I thought it was a great piece, that video, because it was just, it's just such a sort of, it sums up so many different aspects of what happens when you're in the studio. I mean, and also the fact the guy's there going, hey, look, do it like this, do it like that, of somebody, and he doesn't look like he perhaps knows what he's doing, which is kind of fun. But we're probably the less said about that, the better. There is, let me have a look. Oh yes, the I was going to basically take this one a little bit. I need to get this. This is the new the promo for the Korg. And I got one of these because Korg, when they came down last, they gave me one of these, which is like a little USB stick shaped like a micro Korg. And it's like a 2 gig one. It's a really cute little bit of promo. It's made of sort of rubberized plastic. And it's even got like transfers and knobs on the back. And it's from this guy. Now, I've just got to get this picture up because this guy makes all sorts of little kind of cute pieces of electronics. It's called the Drumbro Hip Hop Drum Samples. And he makes, I'm just seeing if I can find, yeah, these little USB keys, so SP1200s, 808, there's an MPC. What I really like as well is the little Yamaha NS10s. I thought that was particularly cute, actually. That's just, I don't know why I thought that was so cute, but it just seemed, you had to have a pair of them, wouldn't you? Just because you could. And they were designed by, I'm just trying to think what the name of the guy is. Hip Hop Drum Samples, yes. And he basically, there was a piece about it. I think Peter Kern did something on Create Digital Music about the kind of cuteness of it and about these things. And it just got me thinking about promo items for music technology. And I wondered if anybody had any kind of favorites or perhaps ones that should be made that haven't been made yet. And Gaz, you're usually full of ideas, though you're looking a bit flummoxed at this. I have rather sprung. This has been in the list for a little while. I just thought I'd sort of mention it, really, because I have another another topic coming up. But you know,
Can you go to Rich first while I think about this?
Rich, you've been dumped on, I'm afraid. It's over to you. But the whole idea, I'm just trying to think of some other ones that were really cool. I mean, obviously T-shirts are as mainly baseball caps, mugs, that kind of thing. But I just really like these little... there was another really cool one that was made. I forget the name of the chap. He made these little paper synthesizers that you could cut out and fold out. And there's quite, you know, there's just some neat little they weren't necessarily so much promotional items. But it seems to me, you know, if you're going to make USB sticks, you've got to make like two or higher capacity as possible, please, because then they're really useful. So, Rich, you're struggling to discover any particular promo stuff, any stunts that perhaps were done to promote either great instruments or perhaps not so great instruments.
I'm trying to think. I really am.
I've done it now. You know what? I did have this set up. And I was hoping, because I got one of these today, which is the Akai, MPX-8, which is a little sample player. And I actually tried to load some very quickly before the show. I was trying to load some samples in, one of which was Howard Sloan's Tumbleweed Moment, which we used to play on the show. And I wanted to assign it to one of the pads. And I really could have done with it then. And it's just a shame. For some reason, these were 16-bit 44-1 WAV samples, and it just didn't read them. So I didn't read the manual and figure out what format I needed.
What format does it take then?
Well, I don't know, because I didn't. It doesn't take MP3s, and it doesn't take whatever. These were WAV files, so I don't know. Maybe I got that wrong. But
Can we just look at that thing again then? Because I think that is... potentially quite a useful little tool. It's quite cheap, isn't it? I think, is it?
Yes, I don't think it's very costly. Let me see if I might be able to give it some juice.
And does it act as a little MIDI control surface as well?
Yes, it will output MIDI notes. Let me see if I can power it up.
It's like Christmas morning around here.
If I plug that in. USB port, power up, there we go.
And then assuming then...
Get my headphones in while you have a look at the LCD.
And the memory size is dictated by the SD card, I suppose.
Focus. Not very bad. Yeah, I can't really... But you get basically pan, level, there's an effect send in it. It's also got MIDI in and out on these little mini jacks. So you can address it, and it'll output MIDI note and MIDI note value as well as trigger a sample. Let me see what else has it got. It's got stereo out on quarter inch, which is kind of cool for this form factor, and headphone out, and an SD card slot. You can just bung one in there. But as I said, I haven't had a chance to figure out what. But it does this. It does. You know, they light up.
I think that's pretty cool. Pretty cool thing.
And presumably, you know, I've plugged it in over USB and it might do something that I haven't discovered. Literally, I just got it out of the box and I have not looked at it at all. But yeah, because there aren't all that many sampler instruments, you know, some dedicated samplers. And obviously,
without a computer.
Akai used to make them. I can just imagine, because I went to the fair a couple of days ago, and I seem to remember there was a topic not that long ago, well, several years ago, when I went to the fair for the first time for ages, probably... after my daughter became old enough to go to them. And I noticed all the people in the fair had little SP303s and they were triggering their, hold tight, here we go. So I imagine we'll see a bunch of those doing the same sort of thing, the kind of carnage. And I think I remember, I don't know, Rich, whether I asked you at the time, have you noticed that you call them carnivals, don't you, carnies, I guess, in the States, where you have a fun fair. Is that right? Or am I off the mark?
You're asking me if we have them here?
Yeah, they call them fun, and whether you get the same kind of deal where the people in the booths have got little samplers that they trigger all their kind of phrases for the waltzers and the go faster. Scream.
It's been a while. It's been a while since I've been to one, so it's very possible that they do.
They were probably just using they were probably using SP1200s back in the day.
No, I can pretty much assure you they weren't doing
I'm
that.
I'm pretty sure they weren't. Well, seeing as my promotional item gig kind of topic just came off completely wrong. I will give you the opportunity if anything's come to mind before I
I have one anecdote.
Oh, Rich, thank you.
When our Prophet 08 arrived, which now needs servicing, but that's another issue. It arrived very kindly with a shot glass, a 30th anniversary or whatever it is, 40th anniversary shot glass from those nice people over there at Dave Smith.
Ah, yeah, no, that was good because now that triggers a memory for me as well, because when I went over there, it was at NAMM, not this year, but the year before, which I think was an anniversary. As you say, was it 30 years? 40? I can't remember. But Dave had some awesome sipping tequila, which he plied me with. In fact, I've got the glass here. It's on the shelf in the kitchen. And I brought it back with me because I've only ever had the sort of tequila you get in the UK is, you know, it's not particularly special. It's just, I'm sure Jose Cuervo is okay, but it's not like the best tequila that you can get if you're in Mexico. And Dave is a real aficionado of tequila, and he gave me... He blew my mind, man, with some really amazing mm-hmm. tequila. And that does strike me as one of the finest promotional items. I agree with you there, Rich. Are you a tequila fan? Do you get good tequila where you are?
I've been known to drink some tequila. It's not my first call, usually.
The end of the night when it's a really bad idea, huh?
Have I had some good tequila? Yes. I've also had some pedestrian tequila, but... yeah, I like a good tequila when it's there.
What should I look for next time I'm going to buy a bottle of tequila?
I'm not qualified to say that. I mean, Patron is the favorite son sort of high-end tequila, Patron, but I know it gets a lot better than that and probably for less money. But I'm not the expert in tequilas.
Yes,
I did go to the Scotch Whiskey Experience in Edinburgh recently, though.
Oh, really? How was that?
That was a blast.
It's interesting. We're way off topic, but seeing as my last topic was way off anyway, there's no real difference. But interesting.
Well, no, they handed me a scotch glass in the shape of a keyboard.
A keyboard scotch glass?
I'm kidding.
How about a keyboard tie that you can drink from? Well, and no, and now we're really getting off topic. No, but interestingly enough, in the scotch world, there's all sorts of whiskies. Indian whiskey is very big at the moment. Has won, and in fact, I'm pretty sure has won. They have this big kind of whiskey prize, whiskey distillers prize, and I think an Indian one has won a couple of years. And there's another country that's coming up big. I think Andy might shout from the other room. What's the other country, Andy, that's making scotch that's not Scottish? Sorry. Japan as well. Japan have really kind of come on as well. So Japan and India.
Mm-hmm.
Amarid, apparently. Indian scotch is the one to go for if you're into that sort. I can't drink scotch anymore. It just makes me sick as a dog almost instantly. Tequila, however, big fan of tequila, specifically margaritas, which I enjoy making. That's not really getting us any music technology stuff, but I have actually, that's okay, because I have actually got a bit of an early doors tonight, because I got to get away and do some chores and things. But that was fun.
Mm.
For all my lack of organisation, but it seems like the stream has held up, so the new technology is working well, and the recording looks like it's working, because I can tell from over here. So hopefully this will all be available shortly on YouTube. And the other thing that I noticed, YouTube has just given us live event streaming status. So we might consider having a go at sending it to a YouTube live stream, because I'd imagine doing this via a YouTube live stream for an hour will probably get promoted somewhere, and we might pick up some new listeners and all that sort of thing. But I don't know what it'll do for the chat room and what have you. So just thought I'd mention it. So anyway, Gaz, thank you very much for joining us this week. Much enjoyment and merriment, and I'm glad we got to talk about booze at least for a bit, even though it wasn't on the side. So what have you got next?
Next, I've got a few. I got a little secret thing I can't really talk about now. I don't know, really. To be honest, I'm looking for more bass work, I think. That's sort of that's kind of floating my boat. So, but as a friend of mine said, they have a habit of finding you rather than you going looking for them. So I'm kind of hopeful that something will happen. along those lines, because it was interesting, you know. I mean, I'm sure Rich will be able to concur with this, but you know, when you play like the big shows, and if the shows go well, you know, you do get like a confidence that's like I'm just bursting to play more at the moment. I mean, I went off and played, as I said last weekend, with David Rhodes and Jed Lynch, who are really mighty fine musicians. And you know, and when you play with great musicians, it just raises your game. You just your playing just sort of seems just to kind of, you know, to kind of go upwards.
Yeah, because I mean, obviously Jed plays with Tony Levin, which I noticed that there was a Facebook status out. I've got this gig. The drummer I'm playing with usually plays with Levin. I'm a bit worried, understandably so.
Yeah. And it was cool. You know, when you play with good musicians, you can do things. Like, for instance, like from a bass playing point of view, I sometimes like to lean forward on things and play sort of really slightly in front of the beat to sort of give a sense of drive and excitement in the music. But then I like to just to pull way back and to sort of go onto the back of the beat then, just maybe to sort of drop from a chorus, going back into a verse or something.
Right.
Now, when you play with good musicians, like really good musicians, they'll kind of stay on their course in a way. And you can do that sort of thing.
Around there, don't try and compensate for you, you mean?
Well, yeah, you know, it's like, it's quite nice. It's not everything's hanging off me. Sometimes I play with some people and, you know, if I do something, it'll just wrong foot them and they'll go kind of wrong. You know, playing with these great musicians, it just kind of, it's quite liberating. You get to be able to be, a better player because you can play off them more. Now, Jed Lynch, he's a great drummer. He's had like 12, 13 years with Peter Gabriel, amongst other people. He's a very exciting drummer to play with because he's one of these drummers. He really digs in and he likes to play sort of, he likes to come down really hard on the top of the beat, you know, and sort of just really, really pounding in there, which is really quite exciting. And he's so loud. He's one of them drummers who can play very loud. But then he can just come straight off the gas and just play in a really open and very light way. So it's, really exciting. So
he's a great drummer, actually. You know, I've worked with him.
Yeah. So the dynamics. And like David Rhodes, you know, he's such an experienced guitar player. And,
you're basically just aching for more big gigs. I know, Rich. Actually, that's the, because, I mean, you've been doing like these big festival gigs and what have you over the summer. Do you find that you come out of it sort of musically excited because, I mean, all that energy that happens at an event like that, say Glastonbury or you know, all the other gigs, you know, it's got to be, can you put it to good use musically?
Absolutely. The energy we get from the audience this year has been unbelievable. And yes, it fuels what happens on stage.
I was thinking you're looking younger. Do you think that's what happens? It's like this kind of like, the endorphins that you must get from these sort of size events and when it goes well and maybe you take a risk and it comes off and those sort of things. I mean, must, like Gaz says, you know, confidence-wise, they must be fantastic. I mean, I'm guessing, I don't know how much leeway you get within your particular gig here, but I mean, there must be elements that you can work within.
There are, but as far as confidence goes, it's more of a group confidence. It's a security in what we're all doing more than any sense of, aren't I the man for me?
Okay.
I don't really dwell too much in, aren't I the man? I kind of tend to dwell in, or how are we all doing together right now?
Right. So I guess that's the thing that, because presumably with gigs that you must have to, like festival gigs, when you turn up, you don't really get a sound check in all cases. And you've got to kind of like, just get on and play. You know you can do that when you've had these sort of events behind you. It's just like, yeah.
Well, also if you have a sound crew like the one that we tour with.
Interesting. Anyway, that was a little bonus topic there to doubly make up for my terrible suggestion of. But there it is.
I know there's something there. I just couldn't
it's all right.
Bring
but
it.
Anyway,
I know.
But I really should go because I have got to be home shortly. But thank you very much, everybody. It's been great fun. And I would like to play off. I've got a little bit of George Duke at the end. I'm going to try and get to the Inca Road solo part because it's just you know, it really is magical. And there is actually a really awesome guitar solo in it as well. But I'm not going to play too much of that because I expect we'll get busted. This is probably the sort of thing that we couldn't do if we were doing YouTube live. But I'll see if I can get this to go. So this is Inca Roads from 1975. So I'm going to fast forward it a bit. It does actually need to go fast forward quite a long way. There's lots of brilliant animation in here, and let me just find the bit.
Bruce Bickford
doing the animation.
Yeah.
It's very hard to watch that without feeling nauseous because the trick was, I'm told, to watch it if you were psychologically enhanced or altered in any way, and see if you could cope with watching this. Here we go. This is George Street on the roads. But the best bit is to come. The Art Odyssey solo is just... Here we go. I don't know what time signature this is. Leaves the release up and then starts playing the rose. Just genius. And that's it. And a befitting end. But thank you very much to everybody. Aww. That was Sonic Talk number 325. And Hooray. Once again, thanks to our sponsors. See you, everybody.